Yo, what's going on? Where am I at? $20 film school. Check it. So, this right here we're listening to, if I have it right, is... Oh, damn, I don't even remember who it is now. Damn. Oh, the Curtis Counts Group. Old, like, jazz group nobody's ever heard of. I really, really don't. The Way Many, I mean, that's jazz, you know? Like, some cats you've never heard of put out the best record you ever heard, you know? But no, this is a song of theirs called Pink... A song called Pink Lady. I think it's an Ellington song, if I remember right. Whatever. They're all Duke Ellington songs. Check it, man. Word Man, $20 film school. Works like this. Run up to a record store, buy a bunch of movies, come back, for a friend, come back, talk about them while we listen to dope music. And today I bought a lot of movies for a friend of mine because I got them super cheap and I had a gift card. We got all of these. Woo! For my good friend Ty. Ty Diggy, what up? AKA Yafet Koto, AKA the Intercontinental Champion. Ty, man, I hope you're doing good. So I interrupted my Word Man all writing weekend to do this, in large part because I had a last minute thing I had to go out for, and there was a little record store nearby, so I was like, Word, get this out of the way. I'm gonna go through this really quickly, because that way I can get back to writing the novel, because these things don't write themselves. Much to the chagrin of myself, my free time. So, one that started this off with is, the movie that, it's actually a movie I saw the DVD of, and I was like, Ty would really like this. And I was like, if I ever see it again, I'll pick it up for him. And sure enough, I saw it again. And it is The Last of Sheila. This is a great movie that, like, no one's ever seen. It's a whodunit. This woman named Sheila, she dies, and then a year later, her former husband, James Coburn, decides to get all of their friends together for one great big, like, yacht trip and do a series of games. So, it's really, really great. I mean, we're talking in the style of, like, Murder by Death or, like the serious version of like, if Clue were a serious movie, it'd be this. Like, Knives Out, like, something like that. Cool thing about this flick, so the story is written by Stephen Sondheim, the great, you know, theater, musical composer, and, Anthony Perkins. Yeah, Norman Bates from Psycho. Together wrote the screenplay for this, and it's more or less based on these sort of, like, elaborate sort of game nights that Stephen Sondheim would have. And then someone apparently, some brilliant producer was like, oh, we should try to make a movie about that. And they were like, all right, cool. So the way the story goes is that they based all the characters off of people they knew who went to their game nights. So, like, if you kind of know anything about 60s Hollywood, you can kind of go, oh, this person is supposed to be that person, and that person is supposed to be that one. It stars a mountain of people that you know. It's got more people. Richard Benjamin, Diane Cannon, like, Raquel Welch, Ian McShane, yeah, Deadwood, James Mason, Joan Hackett, and, like, 6,000 other people. Really, really good movie. Really, really good whodunit. You're going to like it. I know your taste well. That's one you're going to be a fan of. Next joint I got you is a... In my opinion, it is a perfect, like neo-noir joint that's just, like... I'm convinced if you haven't seen... I'm convinced you've either seen it, you think it's the greatest movie ever, or you haven't seen it, but when you do, you will think it's the greatest movie ever. We're talking about Limey, The Limey. This is by Steven Soderbergh. Another movie with basically all these great actors from the 60s. Leslie Ann Warren from Clue, which we just talked about. Peter Fonda's in it. Terrence Stamp. I believe Luis Guzman's... Yes, Luis Guzman's in it too. You know Luis Guzman as being like that Hispanic dude that's in every movie. Anyway, so The Limey's, it's about Terrence Stamp, and he goes to L.A. to try to find out what happened to his, in his daughter's death, and then in the process just decides that he's gonna find out what happened to his daughter's death. He is hardcore in this movie. Absolutely great. style master Steven Soderbergh made it. So, like, it's a very, very cool flick. I think we have another Soderbergh movie in there, too, actually. So you're going to really dig it. It's awesome. This right here is a new joint from the God Fahim. Dope MC.
You fall once, you got to win twice.
Real, real dope. Hey, so check him out. Something I think that the Six tight. Ring, I don't remember the name of the album, but Six night. Ring, Six Ring Champ.
Jordan's on my feet,
and he puts out an album like every 2 weeks. To the streets, like, plenty music.
This is what I do. I hit the
next up, I decided, I know how we are about movies, that I had to get you Coen Brothers movie. And I was like, what Coen Brothers movie do I get him? I'll get him the weirdest Coen Brothers movie ever. That's Mark Fink. And it's about a writer. Poppy, it goes together. Goes together, Poppy. Real simple, real easy. John Turturro is a writer. Moved to L.A. to write his screenplay. And then gets writing club. You know, that phantom illness that only that fake writers get. Knock on wood, of course. Don't believe in it. I'm sorry. Like, you know, like, talk to me when a bus driver gets driver's block, and then I'll believe that. This is one of the weirdest Coen Brothers movies ever. I don't understand a word of it. Nah, it's good, and I dig it. It's just like, it's just so strange, man. The story goes, if I remember correctly about this, that the Coen Brothers were busy writing Miller's Crossing. The classic Miller's Crossing. They got like 2/3 of the way through and then were stuck. And so to get out of that, they decided to write a new screenplay, a brand new screenplay from scratch. Finished this screenplay and then went back to finish Miller's Crossing. That's the story I've heard. Boom. You'll dig it. So the next one I got you... Ow, ear itches. Next one I got you is... So I'm trying to do these really quickly because, like, I got a lot and I gotta get back to work. Next one we got you is Halloween. The classic. The original John Carpenter's Halloween. It's got Jamie Lee Curtis. Mountain of bonus features. I had been doing a lot of research on slasher movies. Just because I'm working on something that I need that information for. That they haven't paid me for yet, so I can't talk to you about. You love the NDAs, right? They're the best. But anyhow, so I've been going through watching and just kind of like going over every freaking like slasher movie ever. And you know me, man. I find horror movies difficult to enjoy. But this one I really, really enjoy. I think it's probably the best of all that genre. This is DJ Hanna. This is really good, though. I really enjoy it. It's a classic, you know that. And yeah, I get to watch it again. So this was really cool with. The next one I was really cool with. As you know, I'm a big Steve McQueen fan. The way all people should be. Both Steve McQueens. The actor and the director. Yeah. This one, however, so think of a Jim Thompson novel. Crime writer, noir author from the 30s and 40s. Jim Thompson. You know who he is. Think about one of his books. Now think about director Sam Peckinpah. Poppy, it's the best ever. And then decided to put Steve McQueen in it. You got yourself The Getaway. It's awesome. So the way it works is Steve McQueen and his wife, Steve McQueen's wife, Allie McGraw, helps him get out of jail so that they can commit another bank robbery. And it goes a little haywire. It's a bank robbery. And it goes a little haywire from there. Because they all do, right? Like, when does the job ever go well? That's the movie Ty, that's the movie we need to write. We need to write the movie where it's a heist where nothing goes wrong. Just a regular heist, you know? Bob and Dave are like, yo, we gonna hit that place up, we gonna get some bucks. And nothing bad happens. That's the movie we gotta write. No one will watch it, but it'll be great. This is Steve McQueen in the 60s, and it's cool. It is coolest. I mean, he's one of the coolest actors ever. Tell you like you don't know. I just watched The Great Escape again last night. Because, you know? And he's in like maybe 15 minutes of that movie. 6,000 other actors. He's still the coolest kid in the room. So much so they call him the cooler king of the movie. Awesome flick. You're going to love it. There's a really great, like, with a lot of these movies, actually. It's probably the theme of this one. Is, like, famous, like, making of backstory to this movie, which is, like, way too long to get into. So if I find a link, I'll include it. Next one is a small flick I don't think you've ever heard of, but it's really, really dope. It's called Dirty Pretty Things. This is really, really good. This is one of them flicks that, like, you'd find on, like, you know, Turner, not even Turner Classic Movies, it's a little too present day for that. Like the independent film channel or something. You'd be like, how come I've never heard of this, you know? So the way it works is Audrey Tautou, Joan from Italy, Amelie, and Chiwetel Ejiofor from everything else. You know, like there's like a 4-year era where Chiwetel's in every movie. It's awesome. Good for him. The two of them are refugees hiding out in London, and what ends up happening is they get involved in the organ selling underworld. Let me get that out right. And it's really good. Like it's like it works as a drama, works as a will they won't they, works as a thriller, works as a suspense, works as international espionage kind of. It's just the kind of flick that you just never see made anymore because they don't make these kinds of movies anymore because, you know, it's not based on a comic book or a horror movie. It's fabulous. You're going to love it. Great ending. Great, great ending. Yeah. This is a Kibi Shakedown with... Is it the Rio Grande song? It is the Rio Grande song. Rio Grande by Kibi Shakedown. Next one up, real simple, man. Christina Ricci and Chains. And Samuel L. Jackson plays the blues. It's called Black Snake Moan. Bobby, it's a... I'm sure you've seen it. It's, as an elder black man like yourself, I'm sure you can appreciate a movie about an elder black man who plays the blues. Because, I don't know, elder black men don't play new age music. I don't know. That's what they tell me. At any rate, good flick. You're gonna enjoy it. And, bingo. Boom. Sorry, we're still working our way through here. So, the next one I got you, I know that you know because I know, and we've talked about this joint. We talked about this joint back when I used to live in West Philly. We used to go on our Wawa runs. Like, yeah, right? It takes it back. I miss those Wawa runs, man. 3 a.m, hitting you up like, yo, I need to get a meatball sub. All right, I'm coming. One of my personal favorites. Night Train to Paris! Burr, 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 burr. Reggae air horn. I can't believe I found this on DVD. Like, that's what made it so cool. I thought I was the only one who, like, ever heard of this movie. You know the movie. So, Leslie Nielsen gets roped into some kind of international... He's got to help get the what's-it back to Paris. And, you know, it's like the hip 60s swinging mod version of a Hitchcock movie. It's great, man. I'm convinced, by the way, I don't think we've talked about this, I'm convinced that the whole, like, train on a holiday in a gorilla suit subplot, like, that John Landis uses in Trading Places, comes from this. Convinced of it, can't talk me out of it. Great flick. Alright, so next thing, a little movie lesson, cinema lesson. Because, you know, that's what we try to do here. We try to expand and inform one's cinematic knowledge. I'm talking mad fast. I really need to get back to work. Alright, so in the 60s in Japan, they were making these fantastic, crazy over-the-top, super stylized, super action-y, super violent, and super sexy movies that they, from a label called Nikatsu, which is Nikkatsu. And they became, the studio became synonymous with these kinds of movies, such that they're referred to now as Nikatsu movies, even if Nikatsu didn't make them. One of the best from that era is a genre called 3 Seconds, well, sorry, the classic rap one, 3 Seconds Before Explosion. It's just way, think of it this way. If Quentin Tarantino were making, like, Japanese gangster films in the 1960s, that's what Nikatsu-style genres are. Plots are borderline irrelevant. It's basically just Yakuza stuff. You know, I'm gonna get back at the Yakuza for doing da-da-da-da-da. This is a pretty good one. Super stylish, super cool. I forget who the director is. Is it Kobai... do I have it on here? No, I forget who it is. But in any case, it's really dope. super fun. If you like this, and I'm putting good money that you will, there's a huge rabbit hole to go down with this as far as, like, the more serious 50s, like, Nikatsu crime dramas, which are more, like, you know, more serious noirs type, you know, like gangster noirs. And then there's the 60s stuff, which is the more Tarantino-y type genres that they go down. And it's fantastic. It's great. It's just, it's awesome. This is also awesome. This is Mal Waldron, a much forgotten jazz organ player, pianist, and he did an album of Billie Holiday songs. And this right here, we're listening to is Strange Fruit, the great Billie Holiday classic. Anyhow, so the next joint I got up for you is one called The American. And this is a movie by Anton Corbijn, who I actually got to meet. I've done a little bit of work for. And real good dude. I was just thinking, because he's one of these guys who's like, I don't know how many people you meet who are like foreign from another country. So he speaks like three languages, casually. And I don't think I've ever met someone who apologized more for their English in a conversation than him, despite the fact his English needed no apology. I'm like, Poppy, I can't speak anything other than this shit, so you're good. he's made a lot of really cool, like I'd say John Le Carré style movies, you know, sort of, you know, like if The Third Man were made in present day, this is the type of stuff it would be. George Clooney is an assassin and arms dealer, and you know, trying to get out of the game. They're always getting out of the game. Again, man, we gotta write some joint where like they're just happily in the job. That's what we gotta do, man. Forget all these like, oh, I'm tired, I only got one more heist in me, man. Forget that. Let's write one about some guy in the middle of his career. Just chilling, having a good time, robbing banks. Big on the robbing banks subgenre. That's like a theme throughout all my work. Anyhow, George Clooney is he's very good in this. The movie takes place, I think, in Italy. I don't remember if they shot it in Italy, but it's supposed to take place in Italy. Fun fact. I forgot that little drop there. Fun fact, I was supposed to be in a movie before COVID. And it was supposed to take place in Italy, and they were going to shoot it in Georgia because of the tax benefits, and you know they can't fly everybody to Italy. And I just remember thinking, like there's no way you're gonna get Georgia to look like Italy. Like, are you crazy? And then he did the trick, which is he sent me 10 photographs, 10 JPEGs, and was like, 5 of these are from Italy, 5 of these are from Georgia. Tell me which is which. And I was like, I'm gonna let you win. I was kind of bummed that movie didn't work out, man. That'd have been some cool thing to be in. Anyhow, American, it's really, really good. It's the kind of like the smart thriller type. The smart Graham Greene thriller movie. Very, very quiet, too. Like, not a lot of dialogue, which I thought was a neat choice. But, yeah. Bungo. So, next one I got for a reason. I don't remember who this is. Oh, this is Cal Jader. Cal Jader's dope. Real dope, like samba jazz. You dig it. So, listen while I talk. So the next one I got you for a reason, but so I know normally you're like, oh, I'm too busy writing my Lovecraft-influenced short stories or my obscure Star Trek joins. Like, what I'm asking you to make is a movie that is as fun as Logan Lucky. That's why I'm sending you this movie. It's literally the reason I got it. Because I was like, you know what? Forget all that, like, obscure Star Trek stuff you're doing and the, you know, all the Lovecraftian type jazz. Like, man, forget all that noise. Make a movie that's as fun as this. Because this movie is super fun. Channing Tatum is an unemployed construction worker who decides he and his merry band of misfits are going to rob the big NASCAR event that's happening a few weeks later. This is a Steven Soderbergh movie. It came out a few years ago. I think, again, only 10 people saw it for some reason, despite the fact it's awesome. James Bond is in it. Han Solo's kid's in it. No. I'm sorry. Riley Keough's in it, too. The chick from... what's the name of that band? Damn. It's gone. It's that fast. Anyway, she's in a dope band, in any case. No, but it's a lot of fun. The movie takes place in West Virginia. The other cool thing they do, which I'm really, really hyped with about this, is they don't laugh at the locals. There's one thing I don't like when people make movies in other places, or movies that, you know, a movie takes place in some area. They go to great lengths to make fun of the locals. I don't like when they do that. This movie, they don't make fun of the locals. Everyone's from West Virginia, but it's good. You know, they don't. Yeah, good stuff. Kenny Holmes is in this. That's the joint. I forget. It's great. Really, really good joint. You're gonna love it. You're gonna dig it. And again, man, watch this and go, you know what? I'm gonna write something fun. Boom. Alright, so now that we got you writing some light, upbeat, happy stuff, let's go into, like, obscure metaphysical westerns. Yeah, because those two beat. That's right, not the most metaphysical of westerns, I can't say the word. Dead Man here with Mr. Jim Jarmusch. I'm sure you know the movie. Johnny Depp, a young Johnny Depp, I forget how old he was in this, but a young Johnny Depp plays William Blake, or maybe William Blake. And he gets shot in going to the West for the first time and ends up on the run with a Native American named Nobody, and then has this sort of, like, trippy trip through the American West. Great flick. Great flick. Can't tell you a word of what it means. Nah, I'm bugging. It's a great, great flick. You're going to really, really like it. And I'm sure you've seen it, but if not, it's the movie that, like, I was like 50-50 on. Like, either you've seen it and you're like, yeah, whatever, or you haven't seen it, and then when you do, you'll be like, they made a movie like this? I'll be honest with you, I've given this a lot of thought. You know how I am about westerns. You know how I am about trying to make people watch more of them. I can't think of another western like this one, which is hard to say, and the genre is overdone as that one. Like, that's a big deal. Last two. So we got you one that I'm sure you already have, because we all have it, but just in case. Because it was really cheap when it was there, and I was like, I'll drop $2 on this. Heat. Classic. Classic. Some writing shit. One of the reasons I think I love this movie so much. One of the reasons I love this movie so much is that it's got five acts. You can forget that. It's not a three-act movie. It's a five-act movie. And the other thing I love about this movie is it is so superfluously long, and you never notice. Dude, you could cut half of this movie out and it would still be awesome. But Michael Mann was like, no, I'm not cutting half of it out. I'll make it even extra longer and we're all the better for it. 6,000 characters were all pretty well developed, despite the fact, like I was joking with somebody that, like, so Dennis Haysbert, who I'm in the middle currently of a Dennis Haysbert, like, film retrospective. Like, I've been, like, watching all of his old movies and surprised at how many great movies he's in that no one's ever seen. I digress. Like, you could take that character out of this movie completely and it still works. You know what I mean? Like, it's so weird. Like, he's literally only there so he can drive the car 2.5 hours later. But he's great in all those scenes. It's fantastic. So is, now, you have to remind me, because I was having this argument with somebody else and they don't, and I refuse to look it up because I think I'm right. If I look it up and I find out I'm wrong, I'm going to be in trouble. Dennis Haysbert's wife in this is one of the Johns in Living Single. I'm like 99.9% sure, but I refuse to look it up because if I look it up and I'm wrong, I'm going to have to eat shit. I ain't trying to do that. Nah, man, it's Heat. I ain't got to tell you how dope this movie is. You know it is. But again, like, think of it this way, like, on some writing shit. Like, it's a movie 7,000 characters in 5 acts, and it still works. Awesome. Now, as you, Ty Dickey, know, one thing we do here in every classroom session here at the Word Man $20 Film School is we include one movie by John Landis. The reason being, as we all know, I'm just a big fan of John Landis. Like, I don't get it either. Now, I know I've done enough of these with you now that you probably own his entire catalog, but just in case, we included the John Landis vampire comedy classic, boom, in the vampire mobster mafia comedy classic, boom, Innocent Blood. Better than I remembered it being. And that was pretty funny. And Don Rickles is in it. Like, if you needed any other reason to watch the movie, Don Rickles is in it. Word. So yeah, man, all that jazz is going in the mail for you. Yeah, I hope you're doing my Philly Liberty Bell here, you know, like, yeah, you know, hope you're doing well. And I'm chilling here, I'm listening to really good music, and I'm now gonna have to get back to working on the novel, because they don't write themselves. Man, I hope you're doing good. Hope you're doing gravy. I'm going to try to make it to Philly sooner or later. These will be in the mail, so they're going to, you'll get to those probably sometime in April. And, yeah, that's all I got. So I'm signing off from the great nation of Brooklyn. Tal Jader in the background. Being funky as all hell. Word, man.